amendment that I have is it's labeled at the top DB C-9-12-8-22, and on this one, so I am moving the amendment that Bill C-9 be amended in Clause 12 on page 8A by adding the following after line 22, E.1, suspend the judge with salary for a period that the panel considers appropriate in the circumstances. E.2, suspend the judge without salary for a period of up to 30 days. B, by replacing line 25 with the following graphs A to E.2. So, on this one, this would allow, there are a number of options which have been added to Bill C-9 that don't currently exist, so that's a good step in the right direction. Right now, the only option really is to potentially remove a judge, which is obviously a very serious step. But Bill C-9, it includes many different, much less serious consequences that could be employed in a judge's disciplinary process, things like reprimand and requiring an apology and things like that. But then it goes, then there's quite a gap, and then it goes to removal. And so as I've been questioning throughout this committee, I've been wondering about the possibility of what about having a suspension possibility with or without salary. And when I guess that started out when I was asking when Minister Lametti was here right off the bat. And so as I kind of voiced it, it's maybe a good way to kind of summarize it, is how I voiced it to Ms. Warner at the Ontario Judicial Council when she was here in front of us. And I said, one thing that I've been wondering about since Justice Minister Lametti testified, I asked him about this, talking about the possibility of suspension with or without pay. And he then passed this issue to his official about the possibility of a disciplinary sanction that would be suspending with or without pay. So Minister Lametti did not comment on it, but he passed the matter to his official, who's here with us today. Minister Lametti's official, Mr. Xavier, senior counsel from the Department of Justice, answered to say that, quote, the bar for judicial conduct is very high. The Supreme Court has made that very clear. Judges really are expected to be a cut above in terms of how they conduct themselves, both inside and outside the courtroom. If you were talking about something so serious that a docking of pay is warranted, you were probably into the realm of removal. Unquote. That was, then I went on to say, that was their rationale as to why they didn't include that in Bill C-9, but I wasn't sure about that, so then I, when I asked for some research as to what the provinces do with provincially appointed judges, and of course when we're looking at federally appointed judges, we're remembering that that also includes, of course, the Court of King's Bench level, which is the lower level of federal court appointments, and in Ontario that would be called the Ontario Superior Court. In Ontario, I said, I noticed that your list of sanctions actually includes suspensions with or without pay, and you talked about that a little bit in your opening remarks. I think that's been in place for quite some time, perhaps since 1994 or earlier. I'm just wondering if you were aware of the considerations that went into including those specific sanctions, and if so, why was suspension without pay ultimately included as a possibility? And then I said, and I'm also wondering if, with respect to the Federal Department of Justice, rationale for not including the docking of pay in this bill, even though it hasn't been amended for decades, 50 years, I said. I'm wondering how you would respond to that, and I'm also wondering, obviously, if you've seen situations where the docking of a judge's pay would be an appropriate penalty. You allow it for up to 30 days, and two of those 11 panels that you have had have done that. I'm wondering if you could give us some information on that and comment on those questions. So Ms. Warner, in her response about that, she wasn't, because this had been done quite some time before, probably 1994 or so, she wasn't aware of the considerations that went into the rationale initially for concluding that, but she said, what I can tell you is I did review the two hearing panel decisions where the panel decided to impose a 30-day suspension, and that was in 2017, so quite recently. She said what the hearing panels in both cases were grappling with was serious misconduct, but on the other hand, the judges in both cases had exhibited remorse, insight, acknowledgement. They had filed many letters of support, not only from judges, but from lawyers and members of the public. They had gone through some remedial training and ethical training. In light of those mitigating factors, the panel was weighing whether it is a recommendation for removal or a 30-day suspension without pay. They felt in light of, as I say, the mitigating factors, a recommendation for removal would be unwarranted, and they combined the suspension with pay with a couple of the lesser sanctions, for example, a reprimand and apologies in one case. They felt that that would serve as a sharp rebuke for the conduct, but it would, as I say, take into consideration these mitigating circumstances. I don't know why 30 days is the magical number, and I'm not suggesting that that's necessarily the limit, but I could see the concern that you don't want to get too close into removal territory. But at the same time, there's a wide chasm between apologies, reprimand, and removal. This helps to bridge that chasm, and you see these hearing panels finding that in these two situations. And I said, great, I agree with you, that really is a huge chasm, as you put it. Then I was asking her about the time frame for the years, and she said, yes, the Act came into force in February 1995, and there have not been any significant amendments to the legislation. So as such, that... allowing for a suspension with or without pay has been allowed for Ontario judges who are provincially appointed since 1995, certainly. She said there have been a few provisions added, but it's been relatively unchanged throughout the 28-year history. And so my amendment proposes that, yes, to go with the 30-day suspend a judge without salary for up to 30 days. That's the limit for that, or suspend a judge with salary for a period that the panel considers appropriate. And then, when considering this, we've received a very helpful memo that was prepared by the Library of Parliament analysts, because I wanted to know about other provinces, what they do for their provincially appointed judge. And let's remember again that for this Judges Act that we're considering, this is for federally appointed judges, but that's not just Supreme Court of Canada, Federal Court of Appeal, Federal Court. It is also a lower court. A relatively lower court, which is the Court of King's Bench in certain provinces, Ontario Superior Court, that level, which trial courts. So that would also include them. So when I looked at the memo from the Library of Parliament analysts, they looked at the different, almost all of the provinces allow this. And when I look at that, British Columbia allows suspension of the judge or justice with or without salary for a further period of not longer than 6 months. Alberta allows that the respondent be suspended with pay for any period, that the respondent be suspended without pay for a period of up to 90 days. Saskatchewan allows suspending the judge with or without salary for a specified period or until specified requirements are met, including a requirement that the judge obtain medical treatment or counseling. Manitoba allows suspend the judge with pay for any period, suspend the judge without pay for a period up to 30 days. Ontario allows suspend the judge with pay for any period, suspend the judge without pay but with benefits for a period of up to 30 days. Quebec allows with a condition, if there's a recommendation provided, then le conseil suspend le juge pour une période de 30 jours. New Brunswick allows suspend the judge whose conduct is in question from the performance of the judge's duties without pay for a period of up to 90 days. Or suspend the judge whose conduct is in question from the performance of the judge's duties with pay and with or without conditions for a period of time it considers appropriate. Nova Scotia allows require the judge to take a leave of absence with pay. Prince Edward Island allows an order recommending that the Lieutenant Governor and Council order a suspension of the appointment of the respondent for a specified period of time or until the occurrence of a specified future event. Newfoundland allows suspend the judge for a period that it considers appropriate until conditions which it may impose are fulfilled or until further order of the adjudication tribunal. So, very comprehensive. And when... another point of view on this, so I decided to make mine only 30 days so that we didn't get into a situation where it was getting potentially too close, so it might be considered to be, a situation where perhaps a consideration for removal would be warranted up to 30 days is a lesser time frame. But another thing that I thought was important in this whole issue is the fact that what we're trying to do with this revamp of this act, which hasn't been revised for so long, this disciplinary proceeding process, is we're trying to avoid situations where judges who are under this disciplinary process continue their disciplinary process on and on for many years and continue through numerous appeals, have a situation continue where they're continuing to get paid by the taxpayers and their situation is unresolved for many years to come. To have only removal, as is currently the case, obviously not appropriate, but then to have such a wide gap between just a reprimand, apology, very lower level sanctions, all the way up to the next sanction would potentially be removal. If a judge is facing that sort of a situation where they are potentially facing removal, perhaps then they're inclined to continue those processes on for so many more years. But if it's a situation where perhaps, they can get a short suspension without pay or maybe a longer suspension with pay, it's transparent. It allows that sort of, a sanction that's maybe more appropriate for the circumstances that warrant it. So I think that that's very important in analyzing this as well. And when I asked the Canadian Judicial Council about this, I also said this because earlier in that panel, I guess it was the Commissioner of Judicial Affairs, Federal Judicial Affairs, and I was referring to Senator Patterson, had asked him about the suspension with pay possibility. And Mr. Giroux had then responded that, that sort of thing can be done right now. A Chief Justice can effectively suspend a judge with pay by just not assigning them to cases. But I brought up the point that's not at all transparent. The public would never know that that was happening. They might just think, maybe that judge is on holidays, maybe that judge is on a sick leave, numerous other reasons. They would never be aware that they're facing a disciplinary proceeding that then has led them, or a potential misconduct allegation that has led a Chief Justice to make that sort of an action against them.
Senator Patterson, could I invite you to sum up? This sure. is an important point,
yes.
but I want to give other people the
yes,
opportunity.
Yes, absolutely. So I just wanted to refer to that. What I said to Mr. Giroux was, with respect to your comments to Senator Patterson about the suspension with pay option, to say that the Chief Justice of different jurisdictions already does this regularly. I think you might want to tell the Justice Minister about that, because when we had the officials about that, they didn't express that as well. The official stated that if the misconduct was so serious that suspension or docking of pay would be considered, then that misconduct would be in the realm of removal, and that was why it wasn't included. But I said, again, emphasize, it's far from a transparent process. The public would never know about such internal administrative assigning a judge on that or not assigning one. And then I also stated that we've also had the opportunity to ask the Ontario Judicial Council about why Ontario does have that included in one of their list of options, and they provided examples, actually, of when serious misconduct met the level of suspension without pay, and yet they determined that removal was not appropriate. Mr. Giroux went on to suggest that perhaps there was jurisprudence reason as to the judicial independence of judges that may be the impact about that. But then I said to him that we've not heard that from either the justice officials or from Ontario Judicial Council, that is a problem with either of those, and so I do not expect that it was. So I would ask you to consider this amendment, and happy to answer any questions. Please consider supporting it. Thank you.
Senator
yes,
Batters.
I wanted to address some of the points that others had been making, which I had specific commentary on. And in that respect, today, for the first time, we're hearing some of these specific concerns about these different issues when, this issue of potentially allowing for a suspension with or without pay in this act was something that I raised actually in my second reading speech. I said that I wanted to know why those considerations weren't in this act when I asked, and that was given, of course, before the minister came here to the committee. I asked the minister specifically about it. He raised none of these concerns, deferred the question to his officials, didn't hear these concerns from the officials then. We asked Minister Lametti to come back. He declined our invitation. Now today we're hearing different concerns that haven't previously been raised. And as well, when the when Mr. Giroux was here, he was telling us specifically about the option of suspending a judge with pay. That's effectively done, he said, by the Chief Justices, by not assigning cases, no problem. Yet now we're hearing today the Department of Justice officials saying that it's not clear that you could suspend a judge without finding that they're not of good behavior. So it sounds like that from what Mr. Giroux was saying, that that's fine as long as it's not transparent. But if we transparently put it in the Act so that the public can know about these situations, that might be a problem. And we didn't hear that concern raised from either the Canadian Judicial Council, who is currently in charge of this sort of process, or from Mr. Giroux. And again, for those reasons, it may have been helpful to have the Minister of Justice come back to address these specific questions, which I continually raised over the last several weeks. As well, nothing in this amendment takes away any powers of the Chief Justices to handle their care and control of their courts. And you know, calling something a leave of absence as compared to a suspension with pay seems like quite a fine nuance there. But also I point out that these provincial systems, for example, Ontario's, I know, has been in place for 30 years. And then when the officials say today that they're not aware that this issue has been litigated, well, so I point out then that for decades, no judge in Canada has litigated this. And we could reasonably expect that those judges facing possibly removal would litigate such a point if they thought that they had a decent shot of winning on that issue. So I submit that my amendment dealing with the issue of ensuring public confidence goes quite some ways to actually ensuring public confidence, to making sure that we can have an efficient disciplinary process that would allow for a sanction which would give something to actually allow judges to receive a real sanction without having to litigate for years and years, costing the taxpayers you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars before they try to go all the way to a removal procedure. So
thank
for
you
those
for
reasons.
That. Brief,